Good morning, Anchor Church. We are so glad that you can be here with us today. We hope that you are encouraged by our worship today, that it may be a chance for you to set aside all distractions and to lift your voices in praise and as a gift to our Lord, even in the midst of this crazy time. We hope that this is a time that you will be able to get up off your couches and lift your hands and just feel the spirit of the Lord around you as we worship today. Thank you for being with us.
Tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken, 'cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand.
Power that Oh, pray. Hey, thank you for joining us. We're praying that our resources will strengthen your faith in God and grow your love for others. If you're not a part of a church or a community group, we would love for you to reach out to us and let us point you in the right direction. We'd love to invite you into our community here at Anchor Church, too. We also want to hear from you. As you watch or listen to this video, join us in the live chat right here on YouTube and leave a comment. And we'd like to partner together with you in spreading this good news with others. So we encourage you to engage with us on the various social media platforms that are linked in the description below. As we begin, grab a Bible, a pen, a notebook. Ask the Holy Spirit to speak to you through His Word. As we continue our series on prayers for the church, let's turn to Paul's letter to the Colossians. Paul opens this incredible book of the Bible by outlining his prayer for them in chapter 1. So let's read his prayer for this church, and then I'll make some comments and apply this prayer to our lives together as we read through it. So we're going to end up reading Colossians 1, 3 through 14, but let's start with verses 3 to 5. Verses 3 to 5, it says, "We always pray for you, and we give thanks to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for we have heard of your faith in Jesus Christ and your love for all of God's people, which come from your confident hope in what God has reserved for you in heaven. And you have had this expectation ever since you first heard the truth of the good news." Their faith and love are remarkable, and Paul says that it comes from their confident hope of what God has reserved for them in heaven. Because they have such confident hope in all that God has planned for them and all that God has reserved for them in heaven, they're living with faith, meaning they're not questioning everything that happens to them necessarily. They're not wondering if God has abandoned them or doubting God's love for them. They're living as though it's true that God loves them. They're living as though it were true that God has some incredible things in store for them now and in the next life. And if you and I knew the unlimited supply of resources that were going to be in heaven waiting for us for the rest of infinity years and eternity, then I think we'd be less stingy maybe, less selfish in these few short years that we have in this life. If we really believed that we could never lose more than we've already gained by God, then I think we'd be less tempted to operate out of fear and scarcity when it comes to loving others. When we have a confident hope in God, that is backing all of our investments, then we can be so generous and hospitable and loving to others with little to no reservations. Something else I want you to see is if you look at the synonym for confident hope in the very same verse that Paul uses. So we'll read verses 4 and 5 again, and then I want you to see the second half of verse 5. It says this, "For we've heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and your love for all of God's people, which come from your confident hope of what God has reserved for you in heaven." And he goes on to say this, "You have had this expectation ever since you first heard the truth of the good news." And what I want you to notice is that the terms confident hope and expectation are synonymous. In other words, for the people who truly believe the promises of God for new life, abundant life, and eternal life, they have a kind of hope that you can count on. Hope in the Bible, just it's not the same way we use the word hope today. So we use the word hope as a desire for something to happen with no guarantee that it's going to happen. We just hope that it happens. But the people of God are not simply hoping that God will reserve something for them in heaven. They have what Paul calls a confident expectation that he has already reserved it. And they have a kind of pressure-relieving trust that God will share everything with us in time. And hope, in this sense, hope means that we're waiting for something that's already been promised to us. The confident hope that the people here that Paul's writing to have about the promises of God and the future we have with God are really prompting them to live confidently here in this life with nothing to fear and nothing to lose. And Paul goes on to say here in verse 6, this same good news that came to you is going out all over the world. It's bearing fruit everywhere by changing lives. Do you see that? By changing lives. He also says that it has changed your lives from the day you first heard and understood the truth about God's wonderful grace. So here's the good news that Paul's referring to. The world is a broken place, and our minds and bodies are broken too. But God loves us and has sent his son Jesus to remedy this problem and to rescue us. And all who understand that Jesus has died in our place for our sins to renew this world and to save broken people will receive forgiveness and they'll experience new life, abundant life, and eternal life with God forever. And those are actually three realities in the Bible, by the way. And all of these things are gifts from God because of Jesus. And as a result, like we studied in last week's message, we're sharing these good things that God has shared with us. We're sharing this good news with others too. And that's how Paul can say that this good news is spreading throughout the entire world. There's more than a virus spreading throughout the world. There's the message of hope because of Jesus that is circling the globe as we speak. And yet, I mean, at least it's made its way to you and to me, hasn't it? And then Paul says that this message is still bearing fruit. It's still showing evidence that it's true. How? Because it's changing lives. The truth about God's wonderful grace and love for you is the only thing that has the power to make a lasting change in your heart and to set you free. And I'm convinced that what would change your entire perspective in life more than anything else would be for you to hear and understand the truth about how God feels about you. If you really believed that he was disgruntled and a little frustrated with you, then you'd live like that. You'd feel like every job loss was a way of God giving you what you deserve. You'd feel like every time you get sick, it would just affirm what you already know, that God really doesn't care about you that much. Or, but if you could hear and believe that God wants to show his goodness to you, to love you, he wants to forgive you, he wants to serve you, he wants to bless you, he wants to restore what they took from you. He wants to heal you, on and on and on. When you hear and understand this truth about God's disposition toward you, it would be life-changing. And while it was life-changing, it was life-changing for Paul, it was life-changing for the people of Colossae to whom he's writing this letter, and it's also life-changing for me personally. And from hearing many of your stories, it's been life-changing for you too to hear about this message. And for some of you watching, that's the step of faith you're going to need to take today. Overcome the cynicism or maybe the self-pity or whatever else is holding you back enough to embrace that there really is a God, and apparently, he really does love you. Now, this is a step of faith that some of you are just going to have to take for the first time. It's also a step of faith that many of us will take again and again for the 100th time. It's good to be reminded of the hope that we have in God because of Jesus, isn't it? Well, we've got to keep reading. We've got to get through this prayer. So let's read Colossians. We're in chapter 1, verses 7 to 14. It says, "You've learned about the good news from Epaphras, our beloved co-worker. He is Christ's faithful servant, and he is helping us on your behalf. He's told us about the love for others that the Holy Spirit has given you, so we've never stopped praying for you since we first heard about you. We ask God," this is his prayer, "we ask God to give you complete knowledge of his will and to give you spiritual wisdom and understanding." Now, this is the first set of things that Paul is asking God to give the people of this church. And he asks God to give them complete knowledge of his will, to give them spiritual wisdom and spiritual understanding. And this is crucial for so many reasons. I'll just give a couple of them. First is that the complete knowledge of his will, it's not necessarily the ability to see the future, as much as it is the ability to know what God wants from us here in the present. In one sense, his will is what he wants or desires. And in that sense, that's what Paul wants these believers to grow more confident over time, knowing how God wants them to live and in making decisions with a settled heart that is trusting the truth of God's word and his love for us. And then I think that would be walking in God's will or coming to know God's will. And now let's talk about spiritual wisdom and understanding that he prays for them to have. As opposed to a natural or human wisdom and understanding, spiritual wisdom and understanding is seeing the world from God's perspective by the ability that his Spirit gives us to realize spiritual things that are beyond what we can see with our eyes. The opposite of this would just simply be seeing the world from just only a human or finite perspective. We can't possibly know everything that God knows. So it's best to assume that when I can't figure it out, I just need more time and prayer and conversations, as opposed to just me coming to my own conclusions. It's really just pride and arrogance when we refuse to admit that we could probably benefit from a perspective that was broader and more balanced than our own. So give in to that. Ask God for spiritual wisdom and spiritual understanding, like Paul is praying for us too. Now, when you slowly, over time, begin to experience the gift of knowing God and knowing what God desires for us, and that's what it means to know his will, to know what he wants and know what he desires for us, and when you have spiritual wisdom and understanding, Paul says that having these gifts from God, that leads us to some really wonderful things. So in verse 10, it's probably my favorite verse for our time today. Verse 10 says, "Then the way you live will always honor and please the Lord, and your lives will produce every kind of good fruit. All the while, you will grow as you learn to know God better and better." How incredible would this be, that the way we live would honor and bring glory to Jesus, that our lives would be producing good fruit, that good things would be happening in our lives and through our lives by showing love to others, and even that we would grow as we come to know God better and better. Isn't that a great line? Learn to know God better and better. Not necessarily learn to know God more and more, but better and better. And that's really what it's like to know God. If you really know him, it's better, and it gets better and better as you get to know him. You might be wishing that you could get to know God like that. But part of why we're sharing this video is just to encourage you and sharing this message with you that this kind of relationship with God is more than possible. It's a reality for anyone who hears, understands, and embraces the truth about God instead of whatever lies that we've been told about God or whatever else we've been told about how he feels about us. We need God to show us his will. Otherwise, left to our own wisdom and understanding, we become control freaks, always trying to fix what we have no power to fix, or anxiety-ridden messes without any hope that anything can be fixed. And neither of those really reflects a confident hope in Christ that Paul is praying for us to have. We need his power, don't we? And that's why he goes on to say in verse 11 here that we also pray that you will be strengthened with all of his glorious power so that you'll have all the endurance and patience that you need. Paul is praying that they would be given the power or ability to endure and have patience. And the hope we have in heaven is sure and steadfast because of Jesus. It's an anchor for the soul. But there are parts of the promises of God that we're still waiting to receive. And the confident hope that we can have to help us endure these troubles and pandemics and trials and hardships of this life and our faith or trust in God, it gives us patience to endure these troubling seasons. And even just in this pandemic, think of the patience required. Patience to wait on coronavirus tests or to endure quarantine or to bear with one another as we're stuck in quarantine. Patience to wait until we can gather together with our church family again. Patience until we can get back to work and so on. Either way, we always need patience. But Paul is also encouraging us to have patience for the long haul as we wait for God to come and make everything right in the end. And that kind of patience definitely requires God's power. We're just not strong enough to be patient on our own. We need to keep praying for God's strength to endure. So back to verses 11 to 14. Paul says this, "May you be filled with joy, always thanking the Father. He has enabled you to share in the inheritance that belongs to his people who live in the light. For he's rescued us from the kingdom of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his dear Son, who purchased our freedom and forgave our sins." Lastly, Paul wants them to be filled with joy and gratitude to God. And the reason for this is in verses 12 to 14, the good news about Jesus. Christ has purchased our redemption and forgiveness, and God has transferred us from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of Jesus, the kingdom of light, and he's given us an inheritance there with him. And these are all the things that are reserved for us in heaven, protected and preserved for us. When our eyes are on this confident, gospel-centered hope, we can be thankful and joyous even in trying times. This doesn't mean that we'll never have hard days or feelings of sadness or even doubt. But it does mean that whatever each day brings, we can reflect on the truth of the good news and allow that good news to fill our hearts with joy and thankfulness to God. The secret to a life of joy is gratitude. It's not just in the good times, but in the hard times too. Gratitude is our way out. And sometimes it's a long way out. But if we stay the course, remind ourselves of that good news and all the good things that belong to us because of God's love to us, then I think we'll eventually begin to experience joy again. And it helps me. It helps me to look back to the work that Jesus did in his death and resurrection and look forward to the hope I have that Jesus will come back to set things right again. And God's Spirit can give you that hope too. God's gospel or good news about Jesus is our confident hope. So let me close with Romans 8:32. "Since he did not spare even his own son, but gave him up for us all, won't he also give us everything else?" Spiritual wisdom and understanding is having this perspective that he has already given us everything else. What good news! Thank you for watching. We hope that you're encouraged, and we want you to take the next step of faith in your relationship with God. If you've never embraced Jesus as your Savior and committed your life to following him, we want to encourage you to do that right where you are. You know, when someone gives you a gift, the most natural response is just to say thank you. God has made the offer of forgiveness and love at no cost to you and me, but at great cost to his son Jesus. And when it dawns on you that God loves you and has made a way for you to live with him forever, the natural response is to turn to him in prayer and say thank you. If you'd like to talk with us more about taking a step of faith to follow Jesus, we'd love to hear from you. Just click the link in the description below to send us a message, and one of our leaders will respond to you right away. To anyone else who's watching, please don't hesitate to reach out to us with any questions that you have, and especially if you have any needs during this time. If you're interested in helping families in need within our church, I encourage you to donate to our COVID-19 Assistance Fund. You can find that link in the description below as well, and we'll use everything that comes into that fund to assist our community during this time. And thank you. Thank you for your ongoing generosity. And again, if you're someone who could use the help, We're looking to help, so please reach out to us and let us know. Thanks again for joining us today. We hope to see you again soon.